Good morning and welcome to the 15th meeting of 2021 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. Following advice issued by Parliament last week, this committee will be held in virtual. The first item of business is a decision to take items 3 and 4 in private. Are the committee members agreed? Thank you. We'll now move on to the substantive part of the meeting this morning, which is our evidence taking session into Scotland's supply chain. We are looking at the short and medium term challenges that are facing Scotland's supply chain and how the challenges and shifts in supply chain are impacting on Scotland's economy. We are also looking at, we're interested in looking at some long term solutions as well. We want to consider how to build future resilience and whether there are opportunities to develop domestic supply chains in Scotland. So I'm very pleased to welcome this morning's panel and the witnesses. Professor Ian Bomfrey, who is Director of Lightweight Manufacturing Centre, Professor Keith Ridgway, Executive Chair of the National Manufacturing Institute Scotland, and Nick Shields, who is Head of Business Support Services at Scottish Enterprise. As always, can I ask members and witnesses to keep the questions and answers as concise as possible, and it's helpful once you ask a question if you could indicate who of our panellists you would like to respond. And that will make it easier for broadcasting to keep us on track for the meeting. I'd like to start the questions. And first of all, if I can maybe start with Professor Bomfrey. So, as I said, the committee is looking at some of the solutions to the supply chain challenges we are facing. And the issues we've identified over the course of the inquiry, because we're now in the latter stages of the inquiry, has been, you know, pressures around COVID, around the different trading arrangements to Brexit, around labour supply and skills markets. And those are the kind of pressure points we've identified. So I'm interested in, as an organisation looking through the papers, you know, you're an organisation who are looking to respond to some of these challenges, but have been in place for a few years. So over the landscape for supply chains has changed dramatically since COVID started. So have you changed as an organisation? How are you responding to, do you agree with the pressures you've identified? And what kind of impact has that made for what you're trying to achieve? Has it made it more challenging? So if you can maybe talk a little bit about where the organisation's at.
Of course. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for having me today. I think the organisation that I run has definitely changed without question. I think we've had to reassess where we can really have impact within the supply chain. It's particularly important for us because the types of organisations that we are looking to attract don't really exist within the Scottish ecosystem in the same way that they do down on the south coast. So I've spent 30 years working in England and in France. The supply chains are much more readily developed for my particular industry. So this is around composite materials and manufacturing with kind of lightweight structures. So these materials, the skills that you need to engineer and design with them, the skills that you need to manufacture with them, don't exist in any great depth within Scotland. So my challenge has been to try and understand how we can seed new companies locally, how we can encourage companies to come to Scotland. You know, how can we provide the skills and the particular unique selling points that would attract them away from the traditional more established supply chain based down in England. So we've had to look at the environment, so look at adjacent areas such as textiles and the chemical industry. There are 525 textile companies within Scotland. So textiles are very much at the heart of composite materials because they are they're layered materials. So we build up fabrics. So this is an area whereby we could maybe encourage, you know, textile companies to move into the more structural materials business and help them along that way. So that's one example of how we are, we've really adapted to understand what the environment that we're in and how best to have some impact on that. And the last thing I would say with that is that we've come up with a concept to try and take some of the capital cost away from people who want to move into composite materials. So we've got a concept for a reconfigurable pilot line, we're calling it, which is a cell-based system, which we would look to, instead of companies coming to us, we would look to take that technology to them to establish it within their organization, and help them along that journey, and hopefully take some of the capital costs away from buying plant and buying equipment to have, again, to have impact. So,
Okay, thank you very much. If I could move to
thank you.
Professor Keith Ridgway, and maybe to put a similar question to yourself. So, as an organisation, you have been established to try and address the issues with Scotland's supply chain, but the current circumstances we're living through has changed dramatically due to COVID and some of the Brexit issues, the trading issues, and inflation, which we've heard again this morning, is putting pressure on lots of different sectors. How has an organisation, has it changed what your aims were, and have you had to, I know it's about trying to grow domestic supply chains, is this situation making that easier or more difficult?
It's more difficult, very much more difficult. If you look at where National Manufacturing Institute Scotland started from, where it developed from, it was an advanced farming research centre. We're very much in the aerospace industry, and as Nimitz has been informed, it's not, you know, it is for Scotland, not just for the Central Belt, and not just for the aerospace industry. So we're finding ourselves now involved in a much wider range of industries, such as chemical processing and food and drink. And in those areas, we're seeing massive problems. You know, food and drink resilience in the supply chain, absolutely huge. Labour problems, and it can only address by automation. I think that's the thing we've got to do. And now we're starting to a much bigger push towards automation, those industries, those lower, what we might call or consider lower skilled industries. From a point of view where we are at the moment, we've got the Manufacturing Skills Academy, which was brought about as part of the National Manufacturing Institute. We're trying to work with and are working with the FE sector, which I think has probably been underinvested for many years and been the poor sort of a relative of the education sector, to add on the digital skills. The digital skills are becoming an increasing problem. You know, we can't hold staff already in NMIS. Companies can't hold staff. We're losing people for double salaries. Companies are waking up to digital skills. I think for a while, companies and pre-COVID, people thought that, you know, the big companies pushing digital, the Siemens Industry 4, was very expensive. Now they found out it actually is not that expensive. So there's a big push in pulling digital skills in. And last week we were down with a forum in the north of England. It's not a Scottish problem. It's a UK problem. And people said the issues were productivity and getting to net zero in energy cost, but the main problem was skills, 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 and more skills. And there is, you know, we have to respond to that. The National Transition Training Fund, which we're operating with, has been a big help. And I think we need to carry on doing more of that work and giving people that digital addition.
Thank you very much. Nick Shields, Nick, would you like to respond and give you an opportunity to maybe set out how Scottish Enterprise are responding to the additional pressures we've seen in the supply chain during the recent kind of 18 months?
Sure. Thank you, convener. Thank you for the opportunity to talk. So part of my responsibility is I look after the Manufacturing Advisory Service in Scotland. So we've engaged with supply chains and manufacturing companies for many years. I guess the huge game changer was the event of the pandemic. We have seen both from the well-known PPE issues that we had experienced, and having to completely realign supply chains along those lines to meet the essential needs for healthcare providers. So a huge amount of our resource in the short term was realigned to that, along with our colleagues in the Scottish Government. And I'm sure you're well aware of the great work that was undertaken there in terms of kind of rediscovering manufacturing capability within Scotland so that we could deliver our own PPE. I guess added to that, over the last few years, we had been engaging on supply chains in advance of the pandemic and Brexit, and companies who have well-established and existing global interconnected supply chains to be honest, you know, they need a real compelling change to do something different and make those changes. I certainly see that the PPE and the pandemic has brought about that kind of that discordant event that gives people a chance to look at things. And we know from the conversations we're having now with enterprises that we engage, the challenges they're having with supply chain disruption has forced them to relook at their extended supply chains and consider resilience. So we're very active in engaging across. We probably deal with around 1,200 manufacturing businesses at any one time across the relationships, including Highlands and Islands in this as well. So that is part of the kind of the proactive conversation we will have with those businesses in asking them what their resilience challenges are and helping to resolve them, with the proposition of is there a Scottish supply chain solution for you, and how can we work with you to help facilitate that?
Because the evidence we heard last week, which was from construction and house building, was the supply chain pressures were causing a degree of sluggishness within the sector because they couldn't get jobs completed or get jobs started. Is that something that you're seeing among the businesses you're dealing with that is creating those kind of downward pressures on their ability to grow? And
yes, we're in an unusual situation where a quote I had yesterday from a business colleague was, I can't enjoy how busy we are, you know, but the business activity has gone up and orders are much higher. You see that from the PMI indexes, the Purchasing Manager Index. Everything is at almost an all-time high, yet we have these supply chain shortages and disruptions. There's compounding factors there. Again, from other businesses I talk to, it's their suppliers can't get the labour to supply them with the components. So this the skills issue that Professor Ridgeley talked about, you can see this playing out. But I can't think of any business, any manufacturing business across Scotland that are not suffering from this at the moment. So our economic trend survey that we kind of have an ongoing running would show that 48% of businesses say that labour shortages is their main challenge, and 30% of businesses, their second main challenge is supply chain disruption. So those factors are all compounding to give businesses these issues. They're busy, but it is a challenge for them to fulfil orders at the moment.
Thank you, Mr. Shields. And I'll bring in Alexandra Burnett, who'll be followed by Mike.
Thank you very much, convener. We've heard a lot about the generalities of problems with the supply chain and solutions over the last few sessions the committee's held. I'd just like to get into some detail in a particular sector, namely agriculture, released this week and last around the problems in the supply chain there, and obviously the knock-on effects to food prices and inflation and the like. So can I ask Professor Ridgeway first, delighted you introduced automation in agriculture. I was just wondering, could you expand a little on what exactly the work you're doing there, and what support's needed, and when you see some of those things actually coming to fruition to actually have an impact on some of those problems addressed in the supply chain? And my second question for Nick, again on agriculture and material inputs, you know, fertilizer is a key input experiencing issues. Can you maybe give me some input into what you're doing, what Scottish Enterprise is doing specifically to address that? And my register of interest regarding agriculture. Thank you very much. Those are my two questions. Professor Ridgeway.
We've just really been awakened really to the problems in the food and drink industry, particularly, which knocks on its agriculture industry. We've done some work on automation in the whisky industry, which obviously is big, and now we're getting more involved in the seafood industry, which does appear to have massive labour problems. We're getting the companies together to try and find common issues and where we can get people to supply into that industry and also help to develop the equipment. But, you know, to be absolutely honest, they're very difficult problems. You know, so if you just take fish and the North Sea, you know, we've got people in Norway and Iceland who've got more automated systems, but as I understand it, they've got a more standard fish size. The North Sea gives you different sizes, difficult thing to handle, and you know, the skill that actually goes into it, we may not consider it a high level of skill, but there's a lot of tacit knowledge in the seafood industry. So I don't think we can underestimate the level of the problem of automation in agriculture and the seafood industries. But you know, the only way we can really address it is get the companies together, try and find the common problems. You know, look at things like, you know, if you look at robotics, it doesn't work fast enough. You know, we found before in the food industry, the robotics is fine for pick and place and new things, but really you've got to be fixed automation and really going at very high speed in the agriculture and food industries. So we are working on it. We're looking to find solutions. We're trying to find the companies who can help us to actually supply into that industry, which is quite difficult. You know, we have a lack of automation expertise right across the UK. So it's the only way, probably longer term, and it is a longer term, is develop the skills, develop the companies to tackle automation, bring in that expertise and grow it.
Thank you very much. And Nick Shields, on the other issue of material inputs, particularly fertiliser. So you're muted.
That's my microphone back on. Yeah, I'll be honest, my knowledge of the kind of fertiliser supply chain is pretty limited. I don't really have much on that. Most of our work with the agriculture tends to be on the kind of those that are involved with a bit of primary production, but then do some value add work. So as Keith said, it's very much focused on automation. My experience of dealing with the agriculture sector is that they're amazing at new technology, and the technology that is used on the field in terms of satellite technology and the equipment that they use as well, highly automated. Our activity probably pushes up towards the kind of more on the kind of food production side, as Keith says, where we see, I see both fantastic examples of automation and new technologies being adopted, but we also see businesses that really could do with adopting new technology. That sector is particularly hit with the labour shortage issue at the moment as well. So I'd have to come back to you on the kind of fertiliser supply chain activity.
Okay. So just to be clear, so does Scottish Enterprise cover the agricultural sector, or does it not fall within their remit? And who does it fall under?
It's agriculture would not be within our remit. We are normally in the kind of business and enterprise level. So that's really a Scottish Government activity, from my experience.
Okay. Thank you very much. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. I'll now invite Maggie Chapman to ask some questions.
Thanks very much, Claire, and good morning to the panel. Thank you very much for being with us this morning. A couple of questions. Nick, you were just talking there about innovation and the need to change our technologies and that kind of thing. And you've all touched on issues of resilience around diversification, around adaptation, being adaptable, being flexible, and of course the issues of skills. I was wondering, could you say a little bit more about the level of innovation activities across your areas, perhaps particularly around developing processes and technologies that will help us address the supply chain issues? What's there at the moment? What do you think we need, and how do we incentivize some of those innovations? And I suppose I'm particularly interested in those innovations that lead directly to supply chain resilience and supporting the industries that we know we can sustain through volatile circumstances and volatile times. If I could ask Nick first, then Keith, and then Ian. Thank you.
Thank you, Maggie Chapman. I would say that the activities of the last 5 years in terms of the investment we've seen across the infrastructure that Professor Bonfrey and Professor Ridgway are part of has been a kind of huge step forward in terms of support, especially in the place agenda. So the 12 advanced manufacturing challenge fund centres have been set up all across Scotland, and in particular areas like Fort William and Annan and areas away from the kind of central belt metropolitan. These give these SME businesses in these areas free to use open access to look at new technologies, digital, robotics, automation, and get them an opportunity to try before you buy and play with these technologies and understand what they can do for their business. There are fantastic examples of businesses who have adopted automation across Scotland, there are examples of businesses who haven't, and it's our job to take that pain away and to get introduce these technologies to them in such an easy and user-friendly manner. So the advent of MSIP in Dundee, you'll have the Robotarium at Heriot-Watt University, you'll have NMIS in Shannon, and the MMIC as well, the Medicines Manufacturing Institute Innovation Centre, and Professor Bonfrey's Lightweight Manufacturing Centre. So in the last 5 years, I've seen an incredible growth in those facilities that businesses can access very readily, very easily, to understand what that new technology could do for them. So that coupled with the horsepower you have with the Economic Development Agency in terms of promoting innovation and getting businesses to look at both the processes and the products, I think is all part of the support network that is fairly unique to Scotland, because I see what goes on in England as well, and there's a great opportunity for those Scottish supply chains to use that and to make them become more innovative and more resilient in the longer term.
Okay, thank you. And could I ask Keith the same questions around innovation resilience and what we need to do to support those technologies?
I think the easiest thing in the UK is to always blame the Germans. So let's blame the Germans, really. Industry 4 was badged by German professors and the German industry as the way forward in automation and digital technologies. The major players in that game were probably the German people like Siemens. And the impression given was that it was very, very expensive. And that really started to come in around about 2016, when we put the bid in for the digital factory. And so we, you know, that's where we're working on, and really we're trying to unpick what the Industry 4 is, what are the 9 pillars of Industry 4, what does that mean to companies, and where can an SME join that journey? And it doesn't have to be by spending £2 million, which is probably the impression that was always given. So there are a lot of quite low cost technologies that can come in sensors, looking at quite old machine designs, you know, the old Bridgeport machines where you can get off better readings of vibration, temperature, better control the process. It doesn't have to be a big spend to get the solution. So increasingly, I think our work now is looking at the low cost solutions to some of these problems, which is very necessary. And, you know, the problem in the supply chain is, you know, we tend to buy on price. And eventually you get down to the point where you go to a low labour economy. And unless we can take that out of the system, we're always going to have that problem. And, you know, the PP was an example where eventually you went down to the point where we're buying PPE from China because it was very low cost. The only option was actually to automate and make it a lower cost in Scotland. Mm-hmm. But you come to the same old problem is, who's going to do the automation? Have we got the expertise, the companies to do it? And do people understand what they've got to do? And it isn't necessarily to throw money at it. You know, and that's really the innovation, is to find lower cost ways of doing it.
Okay, thanks, Keith. That's very helpful. And Ian, want to come in on this?
Yeah, just to reiterate what both Keith and Nick said. So tangibly, some of the things that we are doing are complementary to what's being done in the UK. But definitely we've got a more focus on low cost. So if you look at our sister Catapult in Bristol, so that's the National Composite Centre, they predominantly grown out of aerospace and have really suffered because of the downturn in that particular market. So what we've deliberately tried to do is position ourselves away from there. So look at the kind of low cost, low entry point of access for SMEs, which are the predominantly make up this, the Scottish environment. So we're definitely positioning ourselves there to be more resilient, I think, and offer a better experience for people. I think as well, just the very fact that the National Manufacturing Institute for Scotland exists is a very positive step. You know, it's encouraged people like myself and my colleagues to relocate in the region. There's a lot of people who see Scotland as a desirable place to come and work, and the very fact that we've seeded something that has that they would recognise and has their skill set, I think is a very good step.
Thanks. If I can just ask a brief supplementary to that. As you were speaking there, I was wondering around the connections. You say that the National Manufacturing Institute is really, really valuable. Given what are the interactions and the relationships with not only FE but HE as well? Because I'm aware of quite a lot of university resource is going on innovation. And they're bringing in partners from around the UK and actually around the world to focus in on that. Are there structures, are there facilities that we could be thinking about to make sure we are actually bringing people together in an effective way?
Yeah, they're very much our structures, and we're involved in skills development all the way through the National Occupational Standards. So. From everything from foundation apprenticeships all the way through to NGDs and PhDs. And the outreach goes even further. We're about to host 4 schools within the Lightweight Manufacturing Centre today. So we are around a go-kart challenge. So that's bringing in young people into see what a modern engineering environment looks like and trying to encourage them that, you know, that engineering is not spanners and oil. You know, it's digital, it's high tech, it's about, you know, robotics, and it can offer a rewarding and fulfilling career.
Thanks very much. Thanks, Claire.
Thank you. I'll now invite Gordon MacDonald to ask some questions, to be followed by Colin Beattie.
Thanks very much, convener. I've got one specific question and a couple of general questions. Part of the focus of this inquiry is around the construction sector, and we heard from witnesses last week that the number of sawmills in Scotland had reduced substantially since the 1970s, yet 70% of the softwoods harvested in the UK come from Scotland. And we've also got a situation where most of the timber used in construction is imported. And I was wondering, what are the opportunities to increase the use of wood products in Scotland, and what steps do we need to do to exploit them, given the difficulties of importing from the EU and the fact that timber prices have increased substantially in recent months? And I'll ask Ian first, followed by Keith.
Wood is a composite material, something that we could handle quite easily. We know how to design for it, we know how to engineer for it, so we would be very happy to support companies who are looking to move into automation, for example. So can we do, you know, kind of more prefabricated things and off-site, which just seems to be the drive for a lot of the construction industry. There's a lot around metrology as well, so making sure that it's right first time, things like that. But really just kind of bringing a portfolio of technologies which may come from other sectors to bring to bear on the construction industry. I've also had some experience dealing with civil engineering and architectural firms where the lightweight and fire retardancy of composites is even more of, you know, important now, you know, given recent the recent events. So being able to reduce the weight of the building that we're putting up and using more organic materials and net zero materials is definitely something whereby we could facilitate that, maybe some of those leaps in innovation. We're very comfortable with those materials. So.
Thank you, Keith.
Things is architects specifying it and bringing it into their designs. On the National Manufacturing Institute Scotland, the new site in Inchinnan, we have got a lot of wood in the first part of the building. The entrance to the building is all wood, and you know, it's actually purple. The architects brought in this idea of the moors of Scotland and the use of timber, which is very good. You know. Very good, but it's a very small thing. When you go larger, there's a difference in the way houses are built in Scotland than in England. there's quite a significant difference, much more wood used. The Construction Industry Innovation Centre has been working in this area. You know, we work with these sort of people. There's a big push on modular build, which timber does play quite well into. And again, down in England with the AMRC, where I worked previously, Lango Rock, we're looking at the 24-hour house build. And, you know, it's programmes like that where you bring in timber early on with the architects and take that forward as a programme, but that's the way we increase the use of timber. But we've really got to probably get close to the architects and maybe educate the architects a little bit more on the manufacturing capabilities of timber.
Okay, thank you. Nick?
Yeah, I guess following on from what Keith said, I'm involved in some of the activities in the Supply Chain Development Programme for the Scottish Government. One of them is timber and construction. 23% of houses in England have a timber frame construction, whereas it's 80% in Scotland. And we know there's a public sector, a Scottish Government commitment of £3.5 billion to build 50,000 new affordable homes over the next 5 years. So that there's a particular work stream that is absolutely exploring that in conjunction with the Construction Scotland Innovation Centre, as Professor Ridgeway referred to there, to look at how we can better exploit our own natural resources here and use more of our timber within Scotland. So that there is an active work stream looking at that with my colleagues in the Scottish Government. So it's something that's been looked at right now.
And just on in general terms, is there enough support in place to identify and encourage UK companies in general terms to use local supply chains? And how much collaboration is there between industry, academics and public agencies to establish local supply chains now?
I think the Making Scotland's Future programme, which has turned into the Manufacturing Recovery programme over the last year, I would say is a great example of collaborative working that works across public sector, government and academia. So there's a specific supply chain programme that I'm the senior responsible officer for, looking at, again, drilling in and understanding and reacting to what we've seen, as I say, both from a disruptive nature where, again, the PPE is the example, but many businesses have had this disruption issue, and it's our job. And I always recall Professor Ridgeway comment he made to me a few years ago about, you know, we're in the game of process innovation where we need to make something 10% of the price that it used to be. And that's exactly why we're setting up these centres across to help businesses drive profound transformational change into their processes to really drive down those costs that Professor Ridgeway talked to, because over the years, as we know, things just gravitated towards the Far East. We have these technology centres in Scotland now, and the appetite, I believe, from the private sector to sort of look at, because of the disruption they face, to say that we can do this. And Keith, Professor Ridgeway did point out that the Germans have managed to do it. They retain a huge amount of supply chain in their own country. Many of their businesses are vertically integrated, so they buy in raw material and process it all on site. So it's again, learning from that. But as Professor Ridgeway said, the cost of that technology that they've used has dramatically reduced in the last 10 years. So the automation now, there's a compelling commercial case to do it, and then the economic case about the disruption of supply chains, I think, is a perfect storm where we could do something good here for supply chains in Scotland.
Keith, what's your views about?
I think one of the problems is actually the foundation economy and where we buy things. While we continue within the government's public sector to buy on cost, we are still forcing the supply chain somewhere to go to the lowest cost component. And so somewhere we go to the Far East. You know, unless we can, we've got to make a conscious effort to say it's going to be bought in Scotland, it's got to be a Scottish supply chain, and that needs to go into the procurement specifications to really encourage companies. Because they know if they invest in automation, there's still a danger they'll be undercut by a low-cost economy.
I'm sure one of my colleagues will pick up the procurement issue. But just to finish, Ian, have you got any views about the amount of collaboration and support there is to exploit local supply chains?
Not specifically. I think it's what we could work on is the is the cost of access, I think, to the centre, so to make sure that it's affordable and that there's sufficient funding where required, that the funding's, you know, accessible and has got a low administration burden on companies. So it's just really to encourage them to invest in these technologies, you know, because this, you know, we're setting up the organisations there to help them on that journey, but it needs to be affordable to them.
Okay, thank you. Thanks very much, convener.
Thank you. As procurement has been mentioned, I am going to bring Colin Smith in next, as Colin had looked to explore these issues, and then it will be Colin Beattie. But if Colin Smith is fine to come in earlier, I will take Colin.
Thank you very much for that, convener, for making sure that I'm paying attention. Just on that issue, good morning to the panel. Is there a way in which we can stimulate manufacturing here in Scotland by using and having clear targets around the very substantial procurement that, for example, the public sector has in Scotland, everything from local councils and NHS building schools and hospitals? Is that one way to start to build that stronger manufacturing base here in Scotland? And I'll put that question, obviously, to first of all, maybe to Professor Bonfrey.
Yeah, I think it's the point that Keith made is really powerful. I think we need to be able to give companies a sight of long-term contracts, you know, in order for them to have the confidence to invest in, you know, this transformational piece that they're going through, or that they need to go through. So they need to have assured kind of long-term contracts for them to be able to invest. You know, if you're a 5% margin business, then you know the cost of some of the technologies are still quite prohibitive, even though they're coming down. So we need to be able to really incentivize them along that journey to make them more productive and more efficient in their manufacturing. But you know, that comes at a cost.
I suppose the same question to Professor Ridgway.
We should use procurement clearly to, I think clearly anyway, to buy Scottish. We should buy Scottish, and we should use Scottish supply chains. And that really is a policy decision, I assume. We have to be careful. You know, you can see that it's not a lot of print money. So, but I think if we do sort of insist and manage that supply chains and give people those longer term contracts, they will be able to invest in automation. They will be able to invest for the long term. So, you know, the idea is we spend so much overseas that we can spend that in Scotland, clearly is a thing we should address. But we can't just throw money at very expensive things. We've got to encourage companies to go to automation, which is long term supply contracts.
And could I ask Nick Shields, I mean, based on your work, you know, would we be, if we had very clear targets around local procurement when it came to these contracts, you know, is the sector geared up to adapt to that?
Again, following on from the previous two speakers, I think yes, but there is that upfront capital expense that is required. So when we look at procurement approaches that we take, and we're all involved in organisations that procure things, where we look at our best value, where you reach a minimum acceptable quality, and then it's really down to price. So that does drive many times when it comes to commodity purchasing decisions towards the Far East. One example we had was a PPE manufacturer in Scotland. After the orders were placed on them and they were able to invest, end up managing to produce PP at a lower price than was previously being procured from the Far East. So we have examples where it's been done. Obviously, these were extraordinary circumstances, and that was done in a very quick timetable. So I think a blended approach would be useful. I'd certainly look at resilience and where we see real areas of concern where we think that there should be a capability in Scotland. But I think that economic benefit layered on top of a procurement decision that would have a wider supply chain and gearing impact on the economy, maybe something that could be considered. but it will come at an incremental cost. There is no doubt about that. But I certainly think it's worth exploring. Yes.
Thanks very much. Can I come back to Professor Bonfrey and Professor Ridgway as well? I mean, are there any other policy initiatives that you haven't already mentioned? You've obviously touched on a few issues, and I've mentioned sort of procurement targets, but are there any other policy initiatives that you would like to see from the Scottish Government to tackle some of these supply chain challenges that we have? You've mentioned one or two so far. Maybe come to yourself, first of all, Professor Bonfrey, what other initiatives do you think the Scottish Government should be pursuing?
I think funding needs to be streamlined. I think we spend quite a bit of time trying to match a company and their desires with the appropriate funding bodies, you know, so having that streamlined, to maybe having a single point of contact for funding streams would help everybody out, frankly, I think, because we tend to see a kind of portfolio of different funding appearing. You know, some are quite transient, some are more persistent. Each has a different requirement in terms of administration load, so how much effort you put in them. Some of them are competitive, so there's no kind of guarantee that you're actually going to get the funding for this. So the streamlining would be really helpful, certainly to my organisation. Keith, if you've got very some reviews.
And the same question to Professor Ridgway, sorry.
Yeah, from my point, I think there are probably two things. One quite controversial one. I think we focused quite a lot on low cost commodities, you know, things like the PPE and the food and so forth. There are some very big, very high value items that are in the procurement arena, is that probably the right word? So offshore wind turbines, offshore wind turbine floaters, you know, we want to get 70% or more Scottish production. Have we got the capability to do that? How do we get the inward investment in? We're probably going to need to bring inward investment in. The wind turbine is now probably, that bit is a commodity. So the floater is where the value is. How do we encourage inward investment? Have we got a good inward investment proposition? I don't think we do in Scotland. I don't think we offer enough encouragement to companies to come to Scotland to do that and to set up factories. I think there's a problem around the high level skills such as welders and machinists and so forth, where the FE sector is too broad, and we need to probably, in my view, bring out the manufacturing engineering part of FE and build its image. I think build its image. And so almost, you know, like the Manufacturing Skills Academy, make it a national thing that, you know, you're proud to become an apprentice and do that route. And I think that just generalising on apprenticeships gives it the wrong image. So I think that's important. And looking at other things that are on the horizon, you know, Scotland's got an ambition to be an energy exporter from a policy point of view. Personally, I don't think we can ignore nuclear. And I think it's a big opportunity to deploy and build nuclear in Scotland because it's a clean energy. And it's very hard to meet our net zero targets without nuclear. And I think there's an opportunity for Scotland that, policy-wise, I understand the policy, but I think should be a thing that we just should look at.
Yeah, that's very interesting. So, I mean, you touched on skills in the perception. I mean, what are the other reasons why we've missed that boat, I suppose, around manufacturing, you know, turbines offshore? I mean, Denmark, you know, are so far ahead of us. So what did we fail to do, and what lesson do we need to learn from that?
I don't think we've tend to lose the large scale manufacturing. We've lost the large scale manufacturing, and we lost that in the UK quite a number of years ago. And we failed to invest as a UK in that capability. So if you look at just things like the tunnel boring machines for HS2, we hadn't got the capability in the UK to machine 10 metre diameter. You know, and they went to Austria. if you look at things around some of the wind turbines or what happens in the north in Scotland, is a lot of big things go to Norway to be machined because we haven't got large-scale manufacturing capability. We've got it in shipbuilding, in fabrication, such as Babcock's and BAE Systems, but we haven't got a high-quality, good machine shop in Scotland. We haven't got it in the UK. And these are challenges when you come to these big, high-value products. We've only one forge in the UK. You know, we've Forge Masters in Sheffield. They've now got a second forge, but that was a huge weakness in the resilience of the supply chain. They're big investments, and the return on those investments is probably not been good enough to attract that private sector investment. And it has needed, such as in Forge Masters, the government MOD to step in and solve it. So it is a decision we have to make, is that, you know, if we're going to encourage companies to either come and set up a manufacturing in Scotland or encourage companies to develop that, it's not a cheap option. It's a, you know, the long-term lows, long-term investment required.
Okay, and thank you. I can see that Ian had wished to come in on this line of questioning. Ian, can I throw something else in? I'll let you come in, but can I ask, it's related to procurement. Other panel members have talked about Far East imports. We have had suggestions that we should be doing whole life carbon costing that should be included in the costs for importing goods. And obviously Scotland has ambitious net zero targets. But Ian, you indicated you wanted to come in. Could you maybe pick that up as well, please?
Yeah, sure. Just I wanted to follow on from what Keith was saying about energy, really, because the cost of energy is often quite a barrier to companies coming here. So the if you're talking about heavy industries, then in other countries, then energy is often subsidised. So, you know, that makes it more attractive for those companies. I can think particularly about the carbon fibre manufacturer that that is a big part of my industry. So, you know, that is, we've got SGL up in Muirford are doing very well, but we want to see the kind of more of those companies coming. And those processes are very energy intensive.
Thank you. And do you have any views on carbon costing, whether that should be included?
Yeah, very much. It's very much at the forefront of what we're doing. So we've got, we're investing in life cycle analysis technology. So being able to absolutely analyse, you know, the cost of energy and the environmental impact of processes that are going on. We've got dedicated staff now to look at that. We're investing in software to do that. So it's a service that we should be able to offer companies. And you rightly point out that we should be benchmarking our processes against other competitors, because we might find out that we're more competitive in these aspects, and we need to talk about that.
Thank you. I'll move on. I had plans to bring Colin Beattie, but I understand Fiona Hislop was going to look at carbon miles. I'd be happy to bring Fiona in at this point, and then it'll be Colin Beattie. So apologies to Colin that I've moved you twice, but to keep the flow going, I'll pass over to Fiona Hislop, if that's okay.
So good morning, everyone. Good to see you. I am interested particularly in that issue of how can we marry addressing sustainability and resilience of domestic supply chains with that net zero goal. And obviously a lot of what is imported is from the Far East, and particularly in the construction sector, as we heard last week. So kind of getting back to kind of basics, we know if construction is to help in our recovery and it's a global challenge, is cement. And we were hearing last week about, is there an opportunity to investigate replacements for cement with next generation materials and innovation? And in the Net Zero Committee just yesterday, we heard about the potential in Scotland for carbon capture and storage to also help address some of the cement issues, because we don't address cement, we're not globally and indeed domestically going to be able to help address some of the net zero challenges. So I'm not sure if cement is particularly your area, but it's that concept of how do we marry interruptions of supply chains, how do we do things domestically to help supply key sectors, but also at the same time perhaps become really innovative globally in an area that the world will need in terms of net zero. How realistic would that sort of concept be if we put our mind to it? So maybe Nick, if I can come to you first, and then to the others. And if cement isn't your thing, but you get the concept talking about the carbon miles issue, just as procurement is that, again, a policy intervention that could help that domestic economic innovation agenda? So, Nick, first, please.
Sure, Mrs. Slop. So, cement wouldn't be my area of expertise. I guess I would defer to my colleagues in the Construction Centre and Innovation Scotland, but certainly on the carbon miles thing, yeah, absolutely. I suppose it's one of those things, it's difficult, I guess, in a global supply chain. We know the further the commodity comes from, the more carbon miles it attracts. So how do we account for that in the procurement process, I think, is an interesting challenge. There's a programme that we're running with colleagues in Scottish Government, SibTech Challenge, helping businesses just analyse what Professor Bomfrey talked about there, their carbon impact of what they're doing, and identifying those areas within their business that really do and where they could really make a difference. So I think that would be a really good start point in terms of helping businesses understand their carbon impact through their supply chain. So I think that's something we have to explore. The solutions for which are not there at the moment, but it's definitely something I would say we would explore. But I'd probably defer to my academic colleagues on the cement question.
So Keith, can I maybe come to you? I know NWIS obviously has been driven by a lot by low carbon and digital, and initially in the aerospace sector. But can that thinking be applied to resilience elsewhere, particularly in the construction sector?
Yeah, we can't subcontract our carbon footprint, can we? I mean, that, you know, if we say we've got net zero, but we're buying everything from the Far East and not taking those carbon miles in, we're cheating the system, aren't we? We're cheating ourselves. So we have to be able to measure it. And so, you know, what Ian's saying is right. We need a good, efficient way of calculating those carbon miles. And there is software about. Some of it is quite challenged, and some of it, you know, there's differences in figures. So we need to look at that. But we should definitely put that in the procurement specifications. It should be a consideration. Going on to things like, should we move away from cement's not my area either, but if we wanted to look at something else, then the private sector is very good at stepping up. You know, innovation is good at filling those gaps, but they have to see a market. You know, if there's a market there, there's a business need, undoubtedly somebody will step forward with a solution. Some company will step forward with a solution. So I think it's creating that environment from a business point of view by saying, okay, we do now measure carbon miles. You know, we are going to make it more difficult to use cement. That somebody will say, well, there's a business opportunity for me. I can see a long-term contract. I can invest in innovation. That's what I think the way we tackle it.
And coming back to you, Ian, because you obviously introduced this in terms of that thinking, that marrying of procurement, looking, obviously, you know, we'll be undercut if we're the only country in the world that does this, but actually in terms of leading by example, could this be something that would help drive innovation, but also help build resilience in the supply chain? And obviously we're particularly interested in construction, but it could apply to other areas.
Yeah, definitely. It's a great topic, I think. And it might surprise you, but somebody who runs a lightweight manufacturing centre, I know a little bit about cement and concrete because it's a really interesting material. And I think this is where the academic side of you know, can really help. So there is research going into, for example, using cement for carbon capture. So actually curing concrete with CO2, and then you can lock it into those structures. So this is where we can help with that translational research piece, which is really where we sit. So our centre sit, you know, between academia and industry, and try and facilitate those two quite kind of different personalities, you know, and try and get them to work together. So we can also help with things like, for example, the recycling of wind turbine blades, which is going to be a massive issue. So we've just won a program to help scale up the recycling of wind turbine blades. What do you do with that? Recycle it. So that glass fibre is it comes from the wind turbines is shredded, so it's quite short fibre, but that can then be embedded into concrete and cement. to improve its structural performance, and also it gets rid of the environmental impact of having to dispose of wind turbine blades. So these are very much novel technologies that were that need centres like us to be able to help companies de-risk these technologies and understand their properties in such a way that the engineers can then specify them. They can say, okay, I can see I've got this recycled material here, which has got this performance, and I can use it in that part there. So we can help them with that along that journey with that underpinning data, and also just tie but often quite disparate industries together. So the wind turbine industry there and the cement industry, not traditional bedfellows, but actually that there might be some synergies there with both industries that have a net positive gain.
Thank you, and obviously trying to get the private sector to see the market opportunity in this, not just...
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, definitely. And I noticed Nick wants to come back in before I hand back to Claire, because Colin Beattie has definitely been very patient. So, Nick, I think you wanted just to come in on this.
Well, it came to mind, I'll give you an example. We invested in a university spin-out from Heriot Watt University, who make a recycled brick using the kind of material from construction that traditionally go to landfill that uses only 10% of the energy that traditional brick would require. So it's an early stage spin out. So we have examples ourselves where we've looked at that sector and the K-Brick is called. Kinetic is the name of the company. So we've got really good examples of some fantastic innovation in Scotland that we in Scottish Enterprise help support from a university spin out that really does make a significant contribution to that decarbonisation of the construction sector and its Scottish originated technology.
Okay, thank you very much, Nick, and I'll hand back over to the convener now.
Thank you. I would now like to bring in Colin Beattie, and thank you for your piece.
Thank you, convener. We've had a fair bit of discussion about opportunities in connection with trying to grow our own domestic supply chain. One of the solutions to doing this has been put forward are varying degrees of automation and so on. But automation doesn't work with every sector and every aspect of the supply chain. I'm reminded of evidence that we received where a company was importing mini pizzas from Italy, and they looked at the local supply chain to see if that could be replicated. And the price was four times the cost of the imported item from Italy. Now that's a heck of a lot of automation needed to cover a fourfold increase in costs. Exactly how competitive is Scotland as a location in terms of being able to meet these supply chain needs? Is it simply that the economies of scale are such that as a small nation, for the most part, we're not going to be able to build our own supply chains? And maybe I can start by bringing Keith Ridgway in on that.
I think low cost things we may not want. You know, we want high value manufacturing, don't we? I mean, that's what it boils down to. I think that the one you mentioned there, even pizzas, I think that can be automated, you know, quite easily. I mean, I'm sure they're probably automated in Italy. Italy has run rings around us, to be honest, in automation, in quite mundane stuff. You know, cutlery, things like that were automated very early on by the Italians. So I do think that's, I still think that's the answer. But we don't have to, you know, it's all right, we don't have to do everything. The higher value stuff definitely we need to go for.
But you know, for years I've been hearing that the UK is moving to higher value goods, away from the mass production, more into high value niche areas. But it doesn't seem to have worked so well.
No, I don't think it has. You know, if you take wind turbines as an example, we talked about before. You know, we were slow to move into it. We didn't
I don't know how to explain really. We've lost a capability. We lost, you know, whereas I think Germany and Italy invested in, and France invested in those industries, we didn't. It's a national problem. It's not, you know, it's not a Scottish problem. You know, we don't have large scale machine shops. We have got one forge. You know, there's quite a lot of things where we're limited. We don't have a machine tool build. You know, if you go around our factories and if you go around, you know, the MRC or whatever in Sheffield, it was embarrassing that all the machines come from Japan or from Germany. You know, they're not low cost economies, but we didn't support our industry. So when we've had, you know, downturns, we just let the industry die. So there's been a lot of policies in the past.
So are you saying that it's not just a question of how expensive it is to produce something, it's simply we don't do it anymore?
Correct. Yeah, that's fact. The fact is, on large scales, on large scale things, we don't do it. You know, we couldn't buy tunnel boring machines for HS2. We couldn't buy in the UK. You know, so if you look at the trains for HS2, you know, we don't make trains. So what has happened? If you look, it's the Hitachi have got the big order, and they said they're putting the factory into the northeast of England to build trains. It's not to build trains, it's to assemble trains. You know, the trains will be built in Japan. You know, the components will be from Japan. We have let those industries die, and we've got to rekindle those industries.
So is the problem that the market is not big enough, the domestic market is not big enough to support these industries?
No, I don't think it is. I think that the market is big enough. You could take a variety of things, such as rail. You know, we're complete restructuring of our rail system. You're right the way through from lines through to the systems, to the vehicles themselves. If you look at the energy, power generation, there's big markets. There's also export markets, if we're good at it. But if we lose the capability, and have lost the capability to make large items, expensive items, it's going to take investment to bring that back. Bring that expertise back.
I mean, we're talking here hypothetically about how to grow the domestic supply chain, how to substitute our own products into that train.
Yeah.
But if there's been long term no will to do that, is there any change in that attitude? Is there any indication that there is a willingness to do this now? Yes.
I think we have to keep separating into lower value. And so if you take the seafood industry, which we mentioned before, the labour shortage is such that they're going to have to bring in automation. And then we've got the challenge on skills to bring the automation in. That's back there. If you go right to the other extreme and say we're looking at high value things like wind turbine, floating wind turbine, then the level of investment need is huge. Now, what do we do? Do we develop? Do we let it go and just say, right, that'll go to Norway and Denmark? Or do we say, right, we'll fight back on that? And then we've got an option. Do we bring in with investors in? And such, you know, Acker and people like that who will come and build factories in Scotland and encourage them to develop a Scottish supply chain. But that somewhere is going to need investment. So they've got to see long-term demand in Scotland for that. You know, or do we sort of try and develop locally? Which is very difficult, to be frank. So, you know, we
but is demand in Scotland sufficient to support a whole industry?
Scotland can't do it on its own. No, it is a UK problem. Energy is a UK problem. You know, it's not. Scotland hasn't dropped the ball on its own. It's every, you know, as a nation, as a UK nation, we've not we've not supported our manufacturing industry for things like machine tools. Large-scale manufacturing, we've allowed people to go, encouraged people to go outside. So we have bought from the Germans, we have bought from the French, you know, and we played very fair, I think, on European procurement rules. I don't think everybody played quite as fair as we did. You know, it was always a challenge. We've let our industries die. You know, we haven't got a large-scale machine shop in Scotland. You know, well, can we support one from private investment, or do we need some government encouragement to put that in? Because if you know, it's, again, I go by a good example. If you look at nuclear and nuclear reactors, you have to forge the reactive components in the UK, which is Sheffield Forge Masters. If you don't, you forge it in Korea, in Japan. So then all the primary machining and everything is done in Japan. So we do need these primary industries. We need to encourage them and invest in them.
Can I bring Ian Bamfrey in at this point? Do we have the will and the capacity to actually build these domestic supply chains to substitute our own goods? Is it going to happen?
I would say we've definitely got the will. Yeah, I think it. I see it in my staff. I think some of the things that we're trying to do here are transformational. So I don't think we can compete with the commodities head on. We have to do things differently. So an example of that is, in terms of the composite material supply chain, we're focusing on creating carbon fiber from biomass. So that is something which is readily achievable within the Scottish context. So that biomass for us is wood pulp, paper pulp, things like that. So looking at a local resource, applying our academic prowess to some of those kind of grand challenges, and you're looking to see how we can disrupt. And disruption is something that we're seeing in a number of industries, and it's maybe the opportunity to identify those that we can capitalize on so that we don't have another wind turbine miss, if you like. So we can actually look at, you know, what my background is automotive. So there's huge disruption in that industry right now, the drive to electrification and, you know, autonomy in there. So, you know, how can we address that? You know, where can we actually come up with a coherent set of technologies and the ecosystem with which companies can recognize support through technical support and also financial support to recognize Scotland as being, you know, the place where you come to do your innovation. And from that we'll seed things that we hadn't even imagined, you know, but we just need to have that ecosystem there.
Are you thinking it's not there now?
I think we're building it. Yeah, definitely. I mean, I can see it with NMIS and what we're trying to do. You know, we've got even in our kind of staff portfolio, you know, we've got a young engineer who joined us from NASA, you know, because she recognized some of the things that we're trying to do. And I think, you know, in Britain, I think we do ourselves a disservice. You know, we are actually, you know, We've got the right culture for innovation. We just really need to have the right environment with which to exploit it.
As I said to Keith Ridgway, since ever I can remember, I've been hearing that on a UK basis that we should be taking niche markets, that we should be high-end products and all the rest of it, because we can't compete on the mass manufactured area. So I'm not conscious of a tremendous success in this, and we seem to be talking about this again in connection with these supply chains. I mean, so far everything seems to have been talk.
Yeah, I take your point, absolutely. And I think one of the things we're trying to do is to have sticky investment, so investment that actually sticks and creates jobs and things like that, and that is part of our strategy, and I can send you more details on how, you know, tangibly we're trying to do that, but it won't be overnight.
I'm sure the committee would be very interested in any information you have on that you can share with us.
I'd be happy to, yeah, definitely.
Could I maybe bring in Nick Shields to comment on some of the things we've been talking about?
Sure, Mr. Petey, I am. The manufacturing businesses I deal with, who have their own intellectual property, generally export everything that they make. So there's not, I'd like to see more of them, but they're very export oriented. So if you build a manufacturing business in Scotland, the Scottish market would never be big enough to satisfy that. But that's what you want. You want an export oriented business. Most of our exports that Scotland produce are manufactured goods, and that's a fantastic way of drawing wealth into the economy. And Professor Ridgway would say it's a high skill, high value job. So there is an amount of demand that we can maybe leverage on to help build that capacity, but you would want these businesses to export and not just look at areas where you would think, well, we'll just satisfy the Scottish demand and the Scottish demand alone. I think if I think of some of the success stories what I can think of in the last sort of few years, I'd say look at the space sector. It's kind of come from nowhere. Last week or a couple of weeks ago, I know you had a gentleman on from the hydrogen company, Logan Energy. So very much a skills-based business, very much high skill, producing goods and it's a service business as well, selling data. So that we can see that's to me the sort of typical model of where the success will be: high skill, high knowledge content, export oriented, and using the fantastic academic base we've got across Scotland in terms of software, digital design and engineering. So those areas of where we can see emerging opportunities through our national priorities are areas, I think, whether it's decarbonising heat, zero emissions vehicles, the real opportunities here, I think, to sort of crystallise the capability we're building in Scotland just now with centres that Professor Bomfrey and Professor Ridgway work, but sort of looking forward to driving those knowledge oriented businesses that well, their business should hopefully satisfy what the demand is in Scotland, but export and beyond.
Nick, you seem to be emphasising a great deal more than the other two panellists in relation to the need for economies of scale. In other words, we have to build a market that, or at least a business, a manufacturing business, that not only meets Scottish needs in terms of their supply chain, but must at least in part cover a chain out with Scotland. So we need the economies of scale, from what you're saying.
Yeah, I mean, the businesses, I think you'd struggle to build a manufacturing business that would just satisfy a Scottish demand. I think that the business always has to be outward looking and global looking, but especially if they've got their own intellectual property. So many of the businesses I see can satisfy what the demand is in Scotland, but will go beyond that. And I think that's what we want. It's touched on earlier on about those, I think you mentioned it yourself, those niche products. So the kind of Germans and Italians are good at that, have a very niche proposition but a global offering. It is a question of how do we look at the Scottish opportunity and at the same time use that to leverage. And I'll go back to the PPE. I think that was an amazing example of that. And the businesses I know that are producing PPE, they're all exporting. They're all exporting as well now, but we pump prime them, to use that fashion term, in terms of the demand that Scotland had at the time, and now they're exporting.
Okay, thank you. Back to the convener.
Thank you. I'll now take Michelle Thompson to be followed by Jamie Hogg.
Thank you, and good morning to the panel. I'm going to change the focus a little bit and talk finance. We had more bad news this morning with CPI inflation rising by 5.1%. in the last 12 months. And of course, that was much higher than what was forecast. But in particular, Andy Verity of the BBC says that pressure is coming from rising commodity prices, and prices paid by manufacturers for raw materials are up by 14.3% during that time. So I've got a couple of questions I wanted to explore with you in terms of your knowledge of manufacturing generally. How are businesses coping, particularly SMEs, given the level of debt they're already carrying, whether it's bounce back loans or C-bills? And do you anticipate cash flow problems for the sector with this rise in commodity prices and the supply chain issues we've already discussed? Could I start? I should have said I'd like to ask you all, but can we start with Nick, please?
The UK PMI index we can see for input costs and raw materials is very, very high. My colleagues that I've discussed this with across various trade associations have said that the SMEs in particular are suffering at the higher end of that. That's an aggregate PMI, so there are different price points depending on what volumes you're buying. So the larger enterprises are always able to negotiate maybe a better price. So I absolutely think we will see issues in terms of that. I think the comment I made earlier on, when someone said to me from the business sector, I can't enjoy how busy we are, because of the supply chain disruption issues that businesses are suffering. Absolutely. And I think the SMEs will get bear the brunt of that, unfortunately. So I'd like to think that we hope they can trade out of this. You know, that's, you know, they are busy, the order books are full, but it's we know many businesses that can build up to say 90% completion, but there's those two critical components. So many yards, factories in Scotland may be quite full of part-built products at the moment, just waiting for that final component to come through. And that, I guess, that is a concern, and it's something we need to look out for in terms of those businesses, and just hope that they're, I guess, the financial support systems around them will recognise that and say that, you know, can they trade through this challenging time? So I think it's definitely something to watch. But I guess all businesses are in this because it's an industry-wide issue. So it's something to look out for. Not seeing too much evidence of distress yet. There are always businesses in distress, and I know there's a few construction businesses. Those businesses that unfortunately maybe took fixed price contracts 2 or 3 years ago, and then I've had to absorb the price rises. That's a tragic issue for them, in a sense that they're stuck with that. So I'd like, you'd like to hope that businesses in the whole commercial infrastructure will take cognizance of the particularly, I think, unique circumstances that we're in just now of quite rampant inflation and input costs.
And can I ask Keith and then Ian as well, and then I've got one more question.
We're seeing issues on steel supply, which has been felt very badly by the SMEs. The reason the SMEs feel it so badly is they buy low quantities, quite often specialised steels. They have very little buying power, so they're basically bottom of the list of customers to be served. It's a problem. Whether we can encourage more production in Scotland or in England or whatever, particularly in the specialist steels, but you know, the whole industry is suffering, I think, from my cost. If you look at materials, and the general rule we have is roughly a third materials or a third labour and so forth. Companies are saying that the problem is still labour and skills more than materials. So I think they'll put a price on, and people recognise the price increase because steel increases in price, but they'll still come back, I think, and say, but our primary problem is skills.
Okay, thank you. And Ian?
Yeah, we're suffering from this as well, Minister. I think we've seen the price of aluminium go up 40%, you know, and that's affecting components and tooling that we manufacture from. I think from our own side, we've had to react to that in ways that I don't think will be untypical for industry. So we're looking to the supply chain to see if there are alternative materials. Can we re-engineer our products for those cheaper materials? So we're exploring different avenues. The other thing we're doing to try and have a positive impact on that is we're investing heavily in recycling and reuse technologies. So with those, for example, take the wind turbine blades. So if you, we heard recently that China will soon be dealing with 750,000 tons of recycled, well, end of life wind turbine blades per annum. So that's a huge quantity of material that's currently going into landfill. So while the scale isn't the same in the UK, we're only reusing about 6% of the glass fibre that goes in a wind turbine blade. So we're looking at technologies to try and recover more of that and impart it with higher value properties. So effectively, we've got an indigenous supply chain by the very fact that we're recycling these materials. So we've got more control over the quantities and the costs of that we should be able to feed that back into the supply chain. So none of which is going to happen overnight, but we can see the larger problem on the horizon, and we're trying to do something about it now.
And Ian, on that point, I mean, there's been a few mentions of innovation in supply chain materials that will meet our net zero targets. And I suspect all the convener will be able to come to confirm. I think that's something that is of great interest to the committee, this kind of innovation. But just staying on the financial point, we all appreciate how important innovation is. So a question for yourself then, Ian, Do you anticipate or are you seeing access to finance for this kind of innovation presenting with any problems? Is it difficult to access the capital?
It is. So we've been relatively successful for a young company and that we're part of a £2 million investment in wind turbine blade recycling. So that was an Innovate UK smart grant. The challenge with the smart grants right now is that only around 2% are being funded. So there's a huge amount of effort that goes into putting in an application, getting the consortium partners and everything. So companies are now seeing this as high risk. So they're tending to avoid those types of large grants because they're not being awarded at a rate that allows them to commit those resources to. So anything that can be done to facilitate that, to my earlier point, maybe streamlining the funding, making it easier, have a single point of access to funding, I think would be. It'd be hugely beneficial to SMEs all the way through to primes.
Right, that is very helpful. And again, if there's any further information that narrows down this topic in terms of the type of bids, I mean, having done a UK finance one myself, I appreciate what you're saying. Thank you very much for that. And just to finish off, if either Keith or Ian had any final points before I move on, I'm conscious of time for everyone else. Any final points on investment and innovation finance?
Not so sure on finance, but I think on the innovation materials, I think that is a very valid point. You know, steel is going to be a problem, long-term problem. How we bring innovation to that industry or alternative materials is really good area, a good area for Scotland as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Ian, any final comments before we move on?
No, I think Keith pretty much summed it up.
Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'll now bring Jamie Halcrow Johnson in.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the panel. Can I direct my first question to Nick Shields? Basically, we've covered obviously a lot about the opportunities perhaps for Scottish supply chains and strengthening those. So can I ask what public bodies are doing to encourage inward investments, investors into Scotland to use Scottish supply chains for components and the like?
So from our perspective, the opportunity to attract inward investment, a huge part of it is the infrastructure we already have here. So we have very active, as you know, inward investment colleagues in SDI, and they again, actually deferring to Professor Ridgway and Professor Bromfrey, what we've built across Scotland in the last 5 years in terms of a very attractive proposition by looking at technology centres, innovation centres, manufacturing institutes, the Michelin Scotland Innovation Park, we've built a very industry focused and industry facing support mechanism to assist businesses with material selection technologies, processing and digital and automation. So I think there's been an enormous effort in the last sort of 5 to 10 years to build that attractive proposition. And that's what we see at Glasgow Airport with the Advanced Manufacturing Innovation District as well. So I would say that coupled with our very active and kind of highly successful inward investment team, as you all know, we attract second to London in terms of across the UK. So, but there's been a real focus on that particular technology proposition that will offer a net zero proposition, zero emissions vehicles, decarbonising heat. So I really see there's been a very kind of, I guess, cross a government colleague collaborative approach to doing that, we will hopefully bear the fruit from that, as Keith and Ian have been saying earlier on. I'm so enthused to listen to the fact that people from NASA choose to come here and live in Scotland now. So if we're attracting that sort of talent at the kind of seed end of the new technology, I think that can only be a great thing.
Thanks very much for that. I'll come to Professor Ridgway and Professor Bumfrey, but can I just ask Nick, are there areas where you think there are still gaps or that more can still be done within that?
I think we can always do more. I think we need to learn from areas in the past, such as the kind of the renewables area. But I think there's a huge opportunity to sort of look at the Northeast in terms of a just transition and how, you know, we've not really touched on the fantastic capability those businesses have, and how we can then, you know, leverage that to that kind of net zero future, and the engineering skills that are fantastic in problem solvers, component manufacturers that all revolve around the oil and gas market, and how we best utilise the amazing capability that offers Scotland in terms of driving that forward. So we just continue need to explore how we best use the fantastic skills and resources we've got in Scotland, but look towards the future industries, I guess, and that's the journey that we'll continue to be on.
Thanks very much for that, Nick. If I can go to Professor Ridgeway first, and then maybe to Professor Bonfrey. Slightly along those lines, actually, obviously I represent the Highlands and Islands. We've touched upon some of the examples of manufacturing and business being done in some of the more remote parts of Scotland, but obviously there are still barriers. I was just wondering if you, starting, as I say, with Professor Ridgeway, could outline some of the barriers to, some of our remote areas, Highlands and Islands, particularly Islands specifically, in terms of being part of that supply chain, and what opportunities there are there still?
Some very good things came out of, I'm trying to think of one of the space companies had gone on to, I think it was the Shetlands, and they wanted a part making, and they'd actually gone into Europe for the parts, and a local company stepped up and made them parts within a matter of days. So there are opportunities, you know, really in the islands there. But going back really to almost inward investment, I had a lot of experience of this around Sheffield, where we attracted McLaren, Rolls-Royce and Boeing to invest in Sheffield. And there are about five things, because it's a very competitive market, inward investment. And companies who are coming look for these five things. And that really is skills, you know, are the skills readily available there? Are they appropriate to what they want? Is there space to build, or are the buildings already there that they can move into fairly quickly? Access to research, you know, R&D availability with their support is a factor. And then finance, support finance, and say a soft landing with finance. And I don't think we've got that well organised at the moment. When we dealt with Boeing in Glasgow, we did very well at bringing a One Scotland team together, Scottish Government, Scottish Enterprise, National Manufacturing Institute, you know, the Skills Development Scotland. I thought it was a very impressive thing we did. And it worked, but with other people we've dealt with, I think the thing that's been missing has been actually financial incentives. And there are, you know, we're competing not only within Scotland and the UK, but globally. We're competing for a lot of this thing. So satellite build, we've been dealing with a company. I think they're going to Luxembourg, you know, based on tax incentives. So there's things we can do, I think, with the things we can do to encourage people. I mean, it is a very attractive place to live in Scotland, but it has transport difficulties. You know, those are issues we have to address. So we've got to overcome those by doing other things. So access to research, access to better finance, some spec buildings, I think, is important. You know, we find it quite difficult to find a battery space to put a startup company or an incubator company in. So those are very valuable. I think that's really what it comes down to, that whole package. And, you know, putting them down together, I know in Sheffield, we almost had a matrix over the years of the help that would be given in apprenticeships, they'd be given in research and development, you know, rent rebates or rate rebates. And then the bottom right-hand corner, there was a value to the company, which was really quite impressive then. Building that model, I think, is important.
Yeah, thanks very much. And Professor Bonfrey, do you want to add to that?
Minister, I'll defer to Keith on that. I think he's summarised my views on that as well. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Camilla.
Okay, and thank you. I'd like to thank all the panellists this morning for sharing your experience, your expertise. That brings us to the end of the session. I would invite panellists, if you would like to provide any supplementary evidence following today's session, please feel free to do so. If I could maybe ask if we could maybe get some further evidence from Scottish Enterprise. We were interested in the how many businesses the Scottish Manufacturing Advisory Service supports annually, and how it's impacted and monitored, but we can maybe send you a note just to outline the further information we're looking for. It might be easier to provide that in writing rather than at committee this morning. So once again, thank you to the witnesses, and we'll now move into private session.